Tonight on the show, the legendary Stan the... There we go. How's it? Welcome to the show, wherever you find yourself in the world. Perhaps sitting on your couch in South Africa. Perhaps you're in the United Kingdom. I saw we had viewers out of Singapore. We had viewers out of Canada this last week. We've had viewers from all over the world, from Portugal. My goodness, I can't even run the list of viewers we've had in countries they've come from. It would take too long. But it's been so great having you press the play button on the live show and watching both live. So whichever way you consume this show, thank you for joining me, Tom London, with you for the next 60 minutes as we chat with each other, as we make friends with each other, as we reach out across the continents and across the dark night sky and say good evening, bon dia, bonjour, ça va, sani bonan, Molweni, Avusheni, how's it?
Hello.
And hello. Yeah, that's what you're here to do. You're here to enjoy 60 minutes with me. And if you're live, watching it live, it helps if you're alive, I suppose, and watching it live, then you're going to make some friends in the comment section of whichever Facebook page or YouTube channel you're following on. Like Patricia Ann Skultz, who's first on board tonight. It says, hello, everybody. Bronwyn Griffith is on board. We'll do a couple quickly. Gaynor is on board. People getting on board nice and fast. Don't forget to smash the like button if you enjoy the show so that people can see it's worthwhile watching. Tammy Singh says, good evening and greetings, beautiful people. And we'll have a chat to Stan. And while we're chatting with Stan, you can put questions or pop memories into the comment section down below. Swap memories with each other. Good old radio days. Bring back some memories. Have a good chat about that. Put some questions in the comment section and I will put them across to Stan if you've got some. Otherwise, enjoy yourself with your group of friends in the comment section and enjoy the chat with, I call him, you know, the word legend has been bandied about a bit too loosely in the radio industry over the last 10 or 20 years. I'd say the last 10. Especially if someone dies, they're immediately a legend in this business, even if they worked on radio for 2 weeks. It's like, no, hold on a moment. We need to become a bit more judicious when it comes to using the word legend. And when it comes to talk radio in this country, building radio stations and presenting breakfast shows, then my guest tonight certainly qualifies, and I don't think anyone would dispute that, certainly not in South Africa, although he has worked in America. We'll touch on that in the chat tonight. And I thought we'd have a good old chat about radio, life, and rock and roll with the one and only Stan Katz this evening. Good evening to you, Stan. How's it?
Good to see you.
It's nice to see you too. I mean, we couldn't do this in the radio.
I see you got a whole new thing going with the hair.
Yeah.
Looks good.
Thank you.
I should introduce you to my barber, Ali.
I was going.
Ali Barber. No, Ali Barber.
Oh, man.
He calls himself that.
Are you serious?
I thought I'd start with a gag. Are you serious?
Are you serious? You have a
barber. I call him the 40 Thieves.
I was going to the barber until I thought of starting the show, and I just thought you just look very boring. So I went to a lady down the road and I said, you need to make me pop. And this is what she did. So, here I am with my white hair. Stan, thanks. Thanks for joining us. Good to have you on board tonight. Yeah?
Thanks, Tom. I'm honored. I really am. It's good to see you. Do you care what people think of you?
Hold on a moment. How quickly did you turn that into an interview of me? I haven't even asked you a question yet. You're firing the questions at me. Do I care about what people...
I thought this was a casual, open-ended chat.
All right.
It's a valid question.
Yeah.
It's a valid question because I care what people think about me. Too much, probably.
Yeah.
Because I'm a people pleaser. And I was just wondering, because you are adored and adulated, if there is such a word, by many thousands of people. You've been in the business a long time and you've made a mark. You made your mark, that's for sure.
Do I care?
And
it's a really good question. On one level I do, and on another level I don't. I'll give you an example. When I made my hair this color, I went to the shops and I was walking around with the trolley and I saw a guy poke his wife in the ribs and the kids and say, look there, because I just looked so different to all the shoppers that day. And I think that's something that people find hard to deal with. I don't really. I'm okay with that. I don't mind being the monkey in the cage. Do I worry about what people think about me as a human being? Yeah, absolutely. I don't want to. We've all got our shadow sides. I think we're all trying to become better. That's my story, at least. So yeah, I hope that people acknowledge that or see that I try. I try to be a decent human being. I fail sometimes, but yeah, I care about that. Do you? You said you do. You're a people pleaser.
Yeah, I do. I care. I probably unhealthily. I care too much about what people think of me.
But perhaps it was stronger when
I. But I've learned to live. I've learned to live with it. You know.
Hmm. I think when I was younger, I wanted people to love me and accept me, and I think that was a very big reason I went into radio. Here's your first question: why radio? How did you land up in radio? I mean, aren't you a Northwest boy, Northwest bred?
No, at the time it was the Northern Cape.
Okay.
Mafeking, the most northerly town in South Africa. Today it's part of the Northwest, but when I was there, it was the Northern Cape. It was established, by the way, for people who are fed up with excitement. Mafeking is where... Mafeking is where fun goes to die.
I think it's increasingly.
I had to get out of there, Tom. I had to get out, and I thought the best way to get out was to become famous. And so I play guitar, possibly, and I thought I'd become a rock star. Then I thought, that's too difficult. Let me get onto radio because I could play my favorite tunes and talk shit. And from that, I built a career. I took 15 minutes worth of knowledge and turned it into a career.
Where did you start? Was it Swazi Music Radio?
Swazi Radio. I added the music part.
Oh, really?
So that they wouldn't think it was part of Swaziland. I'll just give you a bit of background there. It was an interesting story. It was the first real pirate radio station in South Africa. The transmitter was located in the foothills of Swaziland, the hills of Swaziland, and it was driven by diesel. There was no communication with the station whatsoever from our studios in Johannesburg. So everything was recorded on those big 10-inch reels.
Yes.
Packed up in metal cases and flown on the scheduled flight to Swaziland. And when the flight was over full, they would kick our tapes off. And Jimmy the Mug would land up driving them to Swaziland.
To get the shows on the air.
So Swaziland was the Swazi radio, Swazi music radio, was the forerunner to 702 because it was owned by the Kershans, who had big interests in Swaziland. Swazi radio never worked. It was the reception was, it was incoherent, snap, crackle and pop, and eventually folded. And I went to work in America with Wolfman Jack, who was probably the biggest radio and television star in America at the time.
Yes.
And when I came back, 702 was just getting going. This was in 1980. And I got a job. There's a story here as well. Swazi Radio, I worked my way up from office boy to music manager to assistant program manager. And while I was music manager, they hired someone from Australia, a guy called Groover Wayne.
Okay.
Groover Wayne his real name was George Darbitz. He was South African, but had lived in Australia for most of his life. They hired him when I was music manager. They made him music manager because of his experience, and I became assistant music manager. So the first thing I learned was about ego. my first reaction was, I'm not going to put up with this. That's my job, and I'm not going to take it to demotion. And then I calmed down, and I thought, you know what? This guy knows a shitload about radio. So if I stick it out, I will land up knowing not just what I know, but I'd land up knowing what he knows. And as it happens, John Birks, by the way, was the program manager.
Birks, he was John, a manager? How was John Birks as a manager?
Terrible. Terrible. Where were we supposed to learn from? John had a managerial position of sorts at LM Radio. He'd worked his way up into, he had a programming manager's job, but John was an artist. He was,
yes.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He wasn't a manager. And no. It was wrong to make him manager. Anyway, the two of them clashed. And John huffed off, and shortly thereafter, Groover Wayne huffed off. No, he was fired. And I found myself program manager, first assistant program, back to music manager, assistant program manager, acting program manager, program manager. And then I saw, and there was a guy, Bill Otto. I won't mention names because I don't want to involve Bill Otto.
Sure.
So I did a report on how badly he was running the station. He was the general manager.
Oh wow.
I was 25. What do you know about politics at 25?
No, you don't.
Corporate politics.
No, you don't. You barge right in. You barge right in.
Barge right in. So I submitted a report to the Kirshens, explaining why he was doing such a bad job and how, in probably so many words, why I would be a better bet.
Mm.
So they gave him the report.
And you were promoted.
I was promoted out the door there and then.
Straight out of the door.
I was out of my ass.
Did you think it was over? Did you think the radio dream was done when you got fired?
Yeah, I took a bet, and I was 25. I did I considered going back to university to finish a law degree, or to do an MBA.
All right, I'm going to ask you. I'm going to ask you to stop for a second because you've frozen on screen, and your audio is also very jittery. Buffering in and out, and I don't think we're going to get that right unless we recall. All right, Stan, what we're going to do is we're going to drop the call, and we'll call you back, see if we can get Stan back on the line, because I want to hear the rest of the story. Do you want to hear the rest of the story? Gainor says, real memories. I want some more. We're talking about 702 and some of the rock star stuff Stan has done, so let's just call Stan back. Get him back on the line. I was chatting with Stan this afternoon and saying, isn't it interesting? We've got all this modern technology, but none of it's as stable as the good old stuff, you know, 30, 40 years ago. Not much dropped back then. All right, we'll keep calling. He normally answers on the second or third ring. Or the second or third attempt. How's it as you watch the show tonight? Thank you very much for tuning in. Good to be with you. I will be with you for the next, scheduled for an hour. Let's see how far it goes. 13 past 9 is the live time in the studio. We'll just see if we can get Stan back. I know he's having a bit of drama with the network on his side, but let's give it another try. We'll see if we can pick it up from where we left off. I was keen to hear what happened after Swazi Music Radio. I'm not sure about you, but I wanted to know what happened after Stan Katz got fired from his job for writing a report on his boss?
Well.
All right, we try that again. Nothing can go wrong, go wrong, go wrong.
Okay, where did we get up to? Where are we out on my ass?
Yeah, you just got fired.
And I got fired. I'll tell you how I got fired. I was busy taping my show. Remember, we taped our shows and flew them to Swaziland. I was busy taping my show, and he stuck his head in the studio door said, can I see you, please? I said, I'm taping my show. I'll see you when I'm finished. I said, no, I need to see you now. So I said, all right. Put it on pause. Went to his office. He said, I hear you're not happy with the way I'm running the station. So I said, that's right, Bill. And I plan to resign. I thought, I saw the axe coming. I plan to resign. He said, do I win? I said, at the end of the month. He said, that won't be necessary. You can leave now. In those days, in those days, it was easy to fire people.
Yes. Yeah.
I like your setting this evening.
Thank you very
on
much.
On the beach.
Yeah, you know
on
what?
On the beach.
No, you know what?
With a bleach blonde surfer boy look.
Yeah.
It's the right,
you
it's
see
the right
this,
setting.
You see what I got in front of me? This is the Concert in the Park double album.
Yes.
We'll talk about concerts.
Which one? We did two concerts in the park. One was in 1980.
Yeah.
And the other was 85. But they were both huge successes. It was the first time there
was
a multiracial. It was the first time that. And remember, these were the dark days of apartheid. This was the first time that we had that they'd had a multiracial event in South Africa. That was 702.
How did you get to 702?
I managed to wangle an interview through an uncle of mine who knew somebody who knew somebody, and I got this appointment. I walked in. There were three people in the interview, three people interviewing me.
Yes.
The managing director, the station manager, and the company accountant. And I said, I poured forth that, I wandered in bucolic and open-mouthed and poured forth the torrent of my inspiration.
Yes.
And informed them that I wanted to be a disc jockey. And I said, we're not looking for disc jockeys. What do you know about programming?
Yeah.
So I said, and I swear this is the truth. I said, if you tell me what programming is, I'll tell you what I know about it. And the interview was over. And I was heading to the door. And I thought, I've got to do something. I'm dead in the water here. As I reached the door, I turned around and I said, I've got to be calm. So I got made assistant administrative assistant, which is a euphemism for office boy. But that's all I was. And I was just happy. I had a foot in the door. And I had my own set of keys. I used to go back at night and run tapes and practice and practice. And every time there was a vacancy, I would submit my audition tape. And then they would appoint someone else. But I stuck it out. Eventually, I think I drove them mad. I would just give him a show and just get him out of our hair.
Mm. And
so
these were the days of music radio. What was 702 called back then? Was it Channel 702 or Radio 702?
It was Channel 702, your rainbow of sound. Now, the Channel 702 and the rainbow of sound was Desmond Tutu's vision for a rainbow nation. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Which was multiracial. It was non-racist. It didn't work because there was just so much distance between the various races. Mm. It was a noble vision, noble in every way, but it didn't work. And also, when you're the rainbow of sound, our logo had all the seven colors of the rainbow. So you can imagine what our printing
costs
were.
What it cost to print the logo.
What it cost to print the logo on T-shirts, on posters, on everything.
Someone had.
And it was famous.
Someone hadn't thought that through. We'll pick up on the 702 story in just a moment, but I'd like to get to some of the messages from viewers and just jog your memory and just throw a few things at you. So the first one is from Barry Bowditch, who says, Stan, do you remember KABC 79? I don't know how they used to say this, the call
790.
Sign. KABC 790 Orange County, Los Angeles. What can you tell us
about
KABC?
I was living in California at the time, and KABC was a talk station. And there was an ex-South African who was the big star on the show. I think he must have originally been British because he had an English accent. His name was Michael Jackson. not the Michael Jackson, but he had a huge following. He was massive. And what I noticed was AM stations, which had originally been music stations, and AM is a massive frequency because it is far flung. It's distributed via, let me not get it technical,
sure.
But with music, you needed to have FM. Mm. They were converting AM stations into talk stations and sports stations. And music moved to FM, talk moved to AM. And so I'm going to fast forward to 702. I got back from the States and got a job and all of that with them. I'm trying to put this in a coherent form. By this time, I went to see 702. They just started, and you won't believe who was running the station.
Who was running the station?
None other than Bill Otto.
Okay.
He was now running 702 after having run Swazi Radio. He didn't like me.
Sure. So eventually you get on air, and before you know it, you're doing the breakfast show on the hippest, most rock and roll radio station of its era. It's time. What was that like? What was it like being?
It was wonderful, because we were making it up as we went along, and we were competing with Radio 5. We were both AM stations and we were both music stations.
Yeah.
And when Springbok closed, if some of your listeners would remember Springbok Radio, amazing station, they couldn't compete with television. Television had just started in 1976, and all the advertising money was moving to television. Soap operas, which were popular on Springbok, were now on television. And there's the ever-present Coke. I was told that there would be Coke available, and I had no idea that it was the drink they were talking about. Anyway, that's another story for another time. So they gave their transmitter network to Radio 5.
To 5 and 5, then became 5, when, 5 went FM. FM, yeah.
They became from Radio 5 to 5 FM. They were on FM and we were on AM, and we were both music stations. And we knew that competing with an AM station on a music format would be, frankly, like sniping at them with a pea shooter.
Mm.
So we had to do something, and we had to do something that would make us competitive within the entire radio arena. And it was Burks, me, and Rena Broomberg. Spent many a night agonizing over what we would do. John was also keen on music, on talk. I wasn't that keen on talk, and we had to find a strategy. And we landed up asking two questions: what can't the SABC do as a whole, and what won't they do? And the answer was simple: they couldn't tell the truth. The SABC and all its stations were part of the propaganda mouthpiece of the apartheid government.
Sure.
So we said, all we have to do is tell the truth. And we went from the magic 702 to talk radio 702. It was a scary time. Nobody had done it in this country before. Nobody had, for obvious reasons, been able to throw open the lines and say, it's an open line.
Yeah, give
What's
me a
on
call.
Your mind?
Yeah.
Mm. What's on your mind? Because they were managing the news to suit their apartheid strategy.
Sure.
So we said, all we got to do is tell the truth. And that's what we did. News became a really important part of our format. If you listen to 702 at that time and any of the SABC stations that carried news, do you think it was two different countries?
I'm sure.
And
is it true that you never told the owners of the business that you were changing to talk?
Well, The day I made the announcement to Izzy Kirsch was managing director at the time, but he was not that involved. The station was running and running well and making lots of money. And I called them together in the broadcast inn, which was the pub that we'd set up, and to announce to the staff that we were becoming a talk station. And then it occurred to me, I hadn't mentioned this to Izzy, because Izzy stuck his head around the door and he said, "Well, what's going on?" So I said, "Izzy, just come with me quickly, I'll explain."
By the way, we've got an entire format shift coming up.
Yeah. And a lot of the guys who were doing music at the time left the station because they weren't cut out for new. Alex J, Neil Johnson, they all went on to bigger and better things, and they were comfortable with the music format. And for 6 months, I thought we might have made the wrong decision.
Really, for that long, 6 months?
Well, it was massive change from a pop station, music station, not playing any music. Staff would come to me ashen-faced and pleading, "Can't we just play some music? Advertisers are complaining." I said, "We got to bite the bullet." And I said, "The reason we're switching to talk is in the interest of the advertisers and the audience. On a music station, advertising is regarded as an interruption. On a talk station, is part of the information or infotainment format."
Sure.
So that was what they went out with to the industry. And slowly, over 6 months, which is actually quite quick.
True.
We had a massive advertising campaign.
When did you know it was gonna? When did you know it was working?
When we would go out on calls to the advertisers or go to listener events, and they would feed back to us our propaganda. For example, we said, "Local is lekker. We can dominate a local station." This is the other weird thing, Tom. All the stations are either national or regional.
Mm.
There was Springbok, which was national. There was Highveld, which was regional. Radio Port Natal was regional. KFM, Radio Contray, was in Cape Town, regional. And we were very local. We were part of we were broadcast into the PWV, the Pretoria Witwatersrand. Pretoria Witwatersrand Vaal Triangle.
Mm.
That sounds terrible. It sounds like PW Werta. So we changed the name from our target area from PWV to 702 Land. And that caught on.
It did, didn't it? You had the song as well, Land of 702. I remember Burks playing it on his show.
We played it on all the shows.
All the shows,
That offended some dyed-in-the-wool colonialists who felt it was sacrilege.
Yes.
We did a lot of... I wish I had... there is a guy who was the promotions manager at the time, Cecil Lyons, kept all the our advertising materials.
Yeah.
We had... bus stops.
Great billboard campaigns.
We won awards all over the world for that campaign. He had lines like 702 for people over five. 702, daily relief from the dry Highveld. Chris Gibbons reads Between the Lies.
Brilliant.
And stuff like that. So we repositioned everyone around us, including the prints, the press. We said, if you want yesterday's news, get today's newspaper. So in other words, we were on top of things. Which
faster.
What's that?
Saying just faster, so much faster.
Just faster, it was immediate.
Yeah. You know, I remember as a kid, and I suppose a lot of people watching will have similar memories if they grew up in the then Witwatersrand area. I remember 702 just being this a rock star station. It had all the you had all the toys. There was a 702 limo, which I hoped I'd see drive down Nigel Road in Springs one day. You had the branded helicopter that was flying over the traffic every morning and afternoon. Aki Anastasio, I think Paul Beresford was the very first or one of the first presenters.
We had two helicopters, one covering Pretoria, the other one covering Johannesburg.
What made you do more? I mean, what made you get into billboard campaigns and buying limos and helicopters and...
Because we wanted to be in your face. We wanted to position the station in people's minds. We were hip. We were, when we were explaining it to advertisers or to audiences or to the staff, we'd say, and we came up with, our line was, rock and roll without the music. Which was very powerful. We got it right. We said we are established, but not establishment.
You've always loved one-liners, haven't you? I mean, I know just from personal conversations with you that you've got. I don't know how you remember all these one-liners. I'm just looking at something coming in from Craig Caldwell now, going Stan Katz, world indoor hang gliding champ. Where does that come from,
Craig? Every time I bumped into Craig, that was just something that popped into my head. I was on air and I said, I'm really chuffed today. I want to announce that I have won the world indoor hang gliding competition. I didn't think it was that funny. But Craig has stayed with Craig all his life. Hi, Craig.
Robert Naismith brings up names now. Let's chat about some of the names. Mike Mills.
Yes. Mike has had a checkered career. He was on 702, did various shows, then he was on Highveld, then he was on Classic.
Yeah.
He's now on Fine FM in Cape Town, and I'm really pleased for him. Such a good guy, such a good broadcaster.
Always a pleasant person to listen to. You just want, you such a friendly voice. Great, great friendly voice. Rob Wheatley. There's a name from the past, Rob Wheatley.
Rob Wheatley, yeah, he left when we became Talk, and I think he's still doing it. He works on the cruise ships as, function organizer.
Alex Jay's name's mentioned, yeah, but he left before, did he leave when you moved to Talk?
Yes.
All right, Nigel Goliath.
He went to Five.
Nigel Goliath wants to know, were you ever at Radio 5? And if so, why didn't you stay? You weren't at 5.
No, I wasn't at 5. A lot of people confuse that. A lot of people confuse 5 with LM. A lot of the guys who were on 702 when it was a music station came from LM Radio. LM was a similar setup to Swazi Radio, who was broadcasting from across the border. And what we enjoyed and got a kick out of and made a lot of money was we rubbed the government's nose in it.
Yeah.
They would go berserk. They went nuts. They would have liked to close us down, but we were licensed to Bophuthatswana.
That's right.
You, as I recall, worked on Bop Radio.
I did. I spent some time doing the afternoon drive show on Radio Bop. Trevor Kramer says hi and says, the unforgettable 702 Morning Zoo, and then written in with many A's, Stanley. What was Stan? was that Ian Crew's voice? Stanley.
No.
Whose voice was that?
That was the book.
Oh, upstairs?
I can't mention the name.
Were you pushing the envelope on the Morning Zoo when it came to acceptability?
Yeah. It was working off the old principle of it's easier to get forgiveness than to get permission. And so they would call us to meetings, government. There would be the Minister of Broadcasting, and foreign affairs. That was Pip Boerter. Can you imagine?
Wow.
Broadcasting and foreign affairs. That was that they could deal with us, because we were a foreign country, recognized only by the National Party government. So we would be called in frequently and told. I mean, it was, the whole thing was just so bizarre. We were broadcasting, our transmitter was from in Botswana, and we were broadcasting from our studios in Johannesburg via a post office, a line supplied by the South African post office to our transmitter in Botswana. And then they would go nuts. They would say, you've got to cut back on your... The other thing we did, Tom, which nobody else had done, is we made up our minds that we were going to become the hub of the 702 land community.
Mm.
And everything was built around taking it to the streets, taking it to the people. That's why we were so visible.
Yeah.
And they would call us in. They would, as I said, they would have shut us down if they could have. Instead, they said, you're not allowed to carry so much news. I mean, what is so much news? So we said, okay, here's what we'll do. We'll send you a list of what our bulletin contains every day before we broadcast it. We bombarded them with faxes. I mean, it would have taken a month sitting in a room reading faxes.
At some point, though, you stepped away from the mic and went into management full time. At around that time, you were named South Africa's best looking man. I think you and Janie Allen were best couple of the year. I think you were marketing man of the year. You were just getting all these accolades and a lot of attention. Even as you moved into management, everybody knew who Stan Katz was. But in your place on The Breakfast Show was John Burks. How instrumental was John Burks when it comes to the success of 702 as a talk station?
Well, John was instrumental in giving me a job on air. He was
really?
The program manager.
Oh, wow.
This was in Swazi days. And to make myself useful, because I was the office boy, but I didn't care. I was, you know, at the end of every month, I would think to myself, and they pay me.
Yes.
So I was compiling pop news and giving it to the jocks to read. I was getting the pop news from month-old pop magazines that we had lying around. And I would give it to the jocks on air, the bulletin to read about pop news, you know, Elton John's hair has split, yeah, that type of thing. So I gave it to John one day, and he says to me, read it. Now, I've been practicing day and night, bombarding them with audition tapes,
yes,
and getting nowhere. And here Birksie says to me, read it.
Mm.
And I thought, I can't read. I'm not ready. I'm not ready. And then I thought, this opportunity is not going to come up again. And I read it. I was terrible. You could hear my knees knocking. I was so nervous. But after that, I got my own show. And so I just wanted to be a presenter, but I discovered I enjoyed the management side of things as well.
Yeah.
I had my own ad agency in 1985. I was doing a part doing 702 part-time. 1985, they offered me the job of sales and marketing director. I grabbed it.
All right.
Sold my shares in the ad agency and worked my way up from sales and marketing director to managing director. And I was doing 1987, the hell of a year for me. I was doing the morning drive, the morning zoo from 6 till 9. I was the managing director, so I was running the station. I was breaking all the rules that I'd set for everyone else, so it just didn't make sense. I was also exhausted the whole time. I don't know, you've done morning shows.
Yeah, they're disastrous when it comes to what they do to your life. I mean, it just destroys your life. Your life's okay for 3 hours a day, but the other 21 are a nightmare.
Exactly. Yeah. It's it gives you one more good reason for dying in your sleep.
Too true. So bring us back to Burks. Did you know what he was capable of when you put him in that slot when it comes to talk?
No, he was so popular. John would have succeeded if he was reading ice cream recipes. he was that popular, and he was super talented. Birksie was the king.
I think so too. Yeah,
he was the king.
Yeah,
no one before or after him. He and I became very close friends.
Well, I want to ask you about that, Stan. So Kelly Davro has sent a message. There's so many memories, even the sad story about the sound engineer who drove the sound desk for John Birks called Kevin Kelly, who passed away, and Birksie was heartbroken. Yes. It was a tight radio family. Was it? Was it tight, and was it a family?
Yeah. People didn't want to go home at the end of the day. I would come, so I moved, before I gave up being on air entirely, I moved to the afternoon drive show, which was from 5 until 7. And then I had, as a managing director, I had my own office with a bar leading into the boardroom. And there was always somebody hanging around who would be more than happy to join me in a drink. And we'd sit there till 2, 3 in the morning just talking crap and drinking.
You must have been the rock star at the time in this country. I mean, you were driving fancy cars, helicopters, limos, running a radio station, being named Man of the Year. What did that do to you?
I think I didn't have the strength of character to manage my newfound fame. But,
sure.
It had its pros and its cons. The cons were you were always on show. Wherever I went, I felt people were judging me. And I didn't like that. And I think that's when I became a people pleaser. I became an applause junkie.
Dancing for the crowd.
Dancing for the crowd. The clown had cried in the alley, you know? So, but the pro part of that was the trips. I had a lot of girlfriends. My life was chaos, actually. It was chaotic.
Do you miss some of it? The chaos?
No. No. It took me many years to get over that. I don't miss the chaos. I'm very into, as you know, I'm very deeply into transcendental meditation.
That's right.
I keep healthy. I work out at the gym. My life is simplified.
How did John Robbie come on the scene? Was that also a Birks story? Is that also connected to
that
John?
That was a Birks story. That was a Birks story. Birks knew him from when he was, he came out and played rugby for the Lions.
Yeah.
The British Lions. And Birks met him, don't know where, but he came up with the idea of having a coach. In other words, somebody reading sports news. And he said, there's this young guy from the UK, hell of a nice guy. And we put him on air. And he became a huge star.
Is it true David Blood went on holiday for a week or two and John was his replacement for 2 weeks, and when Blood came back, he didn't have a job anymore?
Yeah, first rule of radio, don't go on holiday,
yeah.
So, yeah, he went on holiday for a week or two, and John Robbie said, can I sit in while he's away? I said, sure. He was great. He was on fire. When Blood came back, he didn't have a job.
Tell me about Mansfield. I mean, two of the names we've mentioned, Birks and Mansfield, I think both of us were at, we were at Birksie's funeral together. I remember that. And
yes.
Saw Jeremy shortly before he passed. Mansfield must have made Prime Media billions, not millions, billions.
No, he made a lot of money. He did, because, first of all, he was on 702 with Jenny Cruz Williams.
That's right.
And they were doing shock jockery, being outrageous as they could be. And Gary Edwards was the program manager. I was the managing director at the time. And he said, Jeremy would like to move to Highveld.
Yeah.
And Jeremy had said to me in passing, if ever there's an opportunity to work on a music station, I'd like a crack at it. So we gave him a crack at it. And The rest is history, as they say. He was making good money for himself and for the station.
Loretta says, John Burke's, the reason I fell in love with radio as a little girl, his Frank Sinatra rendition imprinted in my memory. My mom called into his show one morning, made us sing Pavarotti for him. Hello, Tom and Stan. John Mosley talks about 702 is resident in one of the buildings, namely 135 Rivonia Road. That's where the Nedbag headquarters are now.
But yeah,
that building, yes, that building should, you know, that building could have told some tales, I'm sure.
No, but before we moved to 135 Rivonia Road, we were in Albert Street, downtown Johannesburg, corner Albert and May and Elof.
Elof, yeah, Atkinson House.
And Atkinson House, that's where the stories are.
Oh, really?
The best stories come from. Oh, yeah. If those walls could talk.
I heard a story that the cops would come in when there were bomb scares and everyone had to get out the building and stand on the pavement, and certain radio, yes, DJs would panic that the Zol they'd brought to work would be discovered by sniffer dogs.
Yes.
It's real radio, yes, rock star stuff. It's got to be good looking back on it and those memories.
Guys flushing their cigarettes down the toilet.
Do you still get a kick out of media? I mean, do you still observe media as closely as you did? Do you still get a kick out of it? What do you think of the online world and what's happening in media now?
Wow, Tom, online world, you're my guru, man.
No, we
oh, absolutely. I learned so much from you. The fundamentals of marketing haven't changed, but it's just become so complex. And the online world is here to stay. Where the world is now in media is coming to terms with artificial intelligence.
Yeah. Let's talk about Kersner for a while and talk about Sun City, because I'm going to roll the Sun City advert on screen. I can't play the audio because it's got Queen's We Will Rock You in it, and Facebook won't like that. But as I roll this video, it's going to bring back memories of sitting probably in the front row or somewhere in the cinema and before the movie it starts. And I'm trying to remember the line, the script of it. There is a place. Do you remember? There is a place.
Yeah, it's my voice. Was my voice?
It was your voice. There is a place where animals have roamed the earth for thousands of years until the dawning of the sun.
That's a brilliant rendition.
I think it's one of the best television adverts that we've ever produced in this country.
I know you do, because you've mentioned it many times when we've been chatting about media and advertising.
Did you conceptualize that, script it, direct,
yes,
it, voice it, the whole lot?
I didn't direct it. We had a proper production company come in and do that. I wrote it and voiced it. And how that came about was when the entertainment center at Sun City was opening.
There is a place like the
Super Bowl. No,
yes.
A place where nature reigns supreme.
That was the time of my life. I was the creative director working for
a place where every morning more than 3,000 workers rise with the dawn to turn your fantasies into reality.
I was the creative director on that account. And when we presented to Sol the launch material that we recommended, he said, let me see the radio. It was Hollywood on fire. It was Hollywood on steroids. He didn't even want to look at it. He said, let me see the radio. And his marketing director, Jürgen Burmeister, said to him, Sol, it's in the budget. And I'll never forget this. He said, can I say something?
No.
Oh, all right. He said, what's so effing magical about the budget? And that's what we went with, just radio. And then as time wore on, we added more and different media.
Yeah.
But what's so effing magical about the budget?
Did you enjoy working with Sol Kersner?
He would tell most people, most men to jelly. He was a nasty piece of work.
Was he tough?
I found it amusing. I would have to cover my face, my mouth, and we listened to him, like he would say, I'd present an ad to him, a print ad, which I thought was excellent. Ian Blake had done the artwork on it and everything, and he'd stare at it for what felt like 10 minutes.
Even if you were heart of stone, Sun City will not you.
That's not worth all of effing shit. There should have been an age restriction on this interview. Or he'd wait for, he'd see some booking clerk walk past his office door, he'd call her in, and he'd say to her, what do you think of this shit?
Alistair Jameson wants to know, did you guys at 702 bring David Hasselhoff, the Hoff, out to Sun City?
Yes.
And I've heard a story where you brought the WKRP crew out to South Africa and they went hooligan on your asses.
Not really. Maybe they were. I didn't find that. It was not in my presence. It wasn't in my presence.
Oh, really?
They were really cool guys. But they must have thought we were a bunch of hicks, because in the States, they... it was a big show, but nothing like they were in this country. It was, what was I going to say? I don't know. Anyway, that was also great radio. That was real radio. And so do I observe media as much? I do. I try and keep up. But we need to have some more conversations. So I can pick your brain.
Dennis Smith's name has been brought up.
Yes.
Did Dennis Smith save John Burks from a crazy fan one morning?
Yes. A crazy fan came in with a crossbow to kill John Burks.
What do you mean came in? What, made it into the station with a crossbow?
He came into the station. Burks was on air. And he walked in with this crossbow. And before he got to the door, Dennis saw this happening and jumped on the guy's back and brought him to the floor. So, yes, he did save John's life.
Now,
but Dennis himself is a character. Dennis would go walkabout for like days on end and say, where's Dennis? Oh, he's gone walkabout.
Alan Pierce, another great character.
Alan Pierce was a personal character. Alan Pierce's cocktail of choice was a tumbler, not a shot glass, a tumbler of tequila.
That's right.
A Ritalin, because it's an amphetamine. It allows you to consume vast amounts of alcohol without passing out. And a joint. That was his staple diet. And so we did a deal with him when he came to work for High Felt Stereo at the time. We made a deal with him. He could have two beers, and the station manager would bring it up to him in the studio. Malcolm Freed. Was Malcolm there when you were there?
Yeah, I was at 94.7 in 1997, and a few shows in, I had to, my show was after Alan Pierce's show. It was the first time I was meeting Alan Pierce. And here's my Alan Pierce story. I walked into the studio a couple of minutes before my show started, right at the end of Alan's, and I found him slumped over the desk, headphones on, music blaring, and just slumped, passed out on the mixing desk. And I was watching the CD count down. It was going 10, 9, 8, 7. It wasn't computerized systems like we got now. When the CD stopped playing, it was dead air. And I started panicking, thinking this guy's going to miss the end of the song. And 3 seconds before the end of the song, he rose from the ashes and he went, 94.7 Highfield Stereo, I'm Alan Pierce, and I'm out of here. And he got up, put his tequila flask and his packet of Camels and whatever else was lying around the place into a bag, and he walked straight into the wall next to the desk. Straight in. He walked straight into the wall. CDs fell from the CD racks. He did a 90-degree turn, and I'm not joking. He did a 90-degree turn, and he then walked into the next wall. Same story. Crash. CDs falling on the floor. He did a 90-degree turn, walked straight past the studio door into the third wall. Crash. CDs fell down. I'm sitting.
And Tom, you just stood back and watched.
I'm sitting
behind.
Were
you on air? You were on air.
I'm about to go on air, and I'm watching the circus, and I'm sitting in the seat, and I'm watching him. And as he hits the third wall, he turns around and he said something to me I've never, ever forgotten. He banged into the wall, CDs flew onto the floor, and he looked at me and he went, "That one wasn't here when I came in." And I thought, you can't make this stuff up. This is, yeah, legend, genius.
Stan, do you remember the car he drove?
He drove a Z28 Camaro or something. It's a big American.
Yeah, Camaro. It's a thing that seated eight for dinner.
I remember journalists coming in and saying they've seen Alan parked on the side of Rivonia Road, passed out in his car. He was having a nap.
And at the mountain, you must have worked at the. Did you ever go?
No, sadly, never.
The mountain is. The studio was a little ways off from the living quarters of the jocks who were working from there. And Alan, instead of walking to the studio, which was probably about 100 meters, he would drive. There'd be track marks in the lawn where he'd driven his Camaro.
You know, when I hear these stories, they're days that I think a lot of people long for, both listeners, you know, long for that edge, and people who work in the industry. I know if I worked in commercial radio now, I wouldn't last 2 months because it's just become, in my opinion, so sterile. And so it's just lovely to hear these stories from you, Stan. Before we go, you mentioned transcendental meditation. How do you move from rock star to transcendental meditationalist?
Well, it wasn't a direct move.
Yeah.
It was over a period of years. I started when I was 19. And then I discovered the joys of hallucinogenics and wandered away from TM. And about 7 years ago, I was in exclusive books. And I saw a book. It kind of leapt out of the shelf for me, at me, called Supermind. And was about transcendental meditation. It was written by an ex-South African, one of the world's top psychiatrists, who was into TM. And I read it and I thought, that's for me. So I went back and started all over again.
And what does it do for you?
Chills you out, brother.
Really?
It chills you out, yeah. You should. We interviewed one of the founders of TM when we were doing the four piece, remember?
That's right. And I'm not sure.
It's not a philosophy. It's not a cult. It's a technique. That's all it really is. It's repeating a mantra for 20 minutes in the morning, 20 minutes in the evening. Effortless. And for me, who's got a mind like a pinball machine, it helped.
All right, I have to apologize because I thought I stripped the audio out of that Sun City advert, and I hadn't stripped. I put the version on with the audio in. So that audio was plain, people saying, we can't hear Stan over the video. So I think we lost a bit of the discussion around Sol Kersner there. My mistake. I apologize. Sorry, I didn't see the messages coming in, and I thought that audio... So I have to make at least one mistake on a show, and it's normally a big one. So that was my mistake tonight. But well, anyway, you got to see the advert with a bit of Stan and me in the background.
I didn't get to see it. I'd love to see it again.
All right, cool. I'll send you the link. It's on YouTube.
It's on YouTube.
It's on
YouTube.
Yeah.
I'll play you. I've got a snippet about 7 minutes of the morning zoo, which I must give you a copy of.
Cool, love to hear it. Well,
yeah, should have given it to you. Now we play snippets of the songs on the on the demo.
Yes,
that you can get away with, right?
Yeah, yeah. I'm surprised we're still on air because Queen, We Will Rock You is something that gets you taken off Facebook immediately. So thank goodness we're still here after that mistake of mine. But Stan, thank you. I mean, the hour's up. I mean, we could talk for another hour or two, and when you and I are alone, we'll end up talking for hours and hours on end. I know from the comments that are coming in, people have loved the chat. You've brought back a lot of memories, and it's good to know that you're still in the business. I know you're busy with various projects and still dabble in the media game and keep yourself busy, and just so nice to see. And thank you for being on the show. As I said when I started the show, there are very few people I think you can really call legends in this business, and the way you helped transform radio in this country, lifted the game or raised the bar and brought in talk radio to South Africa, I think, you know, your middle name should be legend.
Well, I hear the word legend. You know what I hear?
What do you hear?
Old. Tom, you're a legend in your own right.
Oh, thank you. Now I'm hearing the word old.
No, you're not old. You're the next generation.
I don't think so.
And let me tell you, I monitor what goes on radio. Tom, yeah. What you're doing is reaching an audience that no other radio station in this country is doing. So you're on your way, bud.
Stan, thank you. I appreciate the compliments. And just so you know, as you look at the sign behind me, No More Lonely Nights, I take Stan's advice very, very seriously, especially when it comes to marketing. And just before, about 3 weeks before the show started, I had a whole lot of taglines that I was considering using, and I sat down with Stan and ran through them. And as I said, No More Lonely Nights, he said, that's the one. And I felt that it was as well. So, as you look at that behind me, and as part of the DNA of the show, No More Lonely Nights, know that it's a Stan Katz approved slogan. Stan, thank you. You enjoy
Thanks,
the night,
Tom.
And I'll chat to you soon. And thank you for your time, and thank you for telling us all these stories and taking us back into the past and bringing back memories. I really do appreciate it.
Sorry if it's a bit incoherent, but thanks, Tom.
No, sounding
thank
great.
You.
Okay, and we'll chat soon, Stan. Thank you.
Yes, thanks, Tom.
Take care. Bye now. Legendary Stan Katz. Oh, man. I feel quite embarrassed that I had the song on over that Sun City advert. That's embarrassing me now, because that was something that I just didn't want to do. Listen, I hope you liked it. We're trying different things. I'm going to be completely honest with you. There's so many different things you can do in a one-hour show. You can fill it with voice notes. You can fill it with calls. You can put interviews on. You can have long, extended conversations like we've just had. And honestly, I'm trying to find the right mix, both across the 60 minutes and then the 5 days a week. I've got a whole lot of ideas that I want to put in. But tonight I wanted to have someone on with me for an hour and give you an interview, deliver an interview to you. And I hope that you enjoyed that. So if you enjoyed it, and I take your, I take your advice and your criticism really seriously. So if you enjoyed that interview and you'd like to see an interview or two like that a week, let me know. Yeah, Tom, I think you should only do interviews, or give us one or two of those a week. Let me know in the comments section so that when I go back and watch the show and I read the comments, I can work out whether it hit the sweet spot with you. Of course, we've got Facebook metrics and YouTube metrics. We can see, numbers now, but I like sentiment. And if you could just pop something in the comments section and tell me what you thought and how much of it you want, I'll give it to you. I'll deliver it to you. Tomorrow night, we'll do a bit more talking, chatting between you and I. Perhaps we'll open the lines and we'll run a topic and we'll do a bit of talk back and chat to each other. Remember that you can leave a voice note on the voice note line. The show's got its own number, 067-219-7893. You can leave a note now. You can leave a note in the middle of the night. If something inspires you during the day, send me a voice note. People are sending pictures. We'll put some of those pictures up on the show. I got some pictures from my brother Nick in the bush, held up by giraffes in his driveway as he got home this morning or yesterday. Stuff like that. You got something you want to put on the show, send it to that number. You got an idea, you've got a thought, you want to reach out and say hello, you just leave us a voice note. And you can do it at any time, 067-219-7893. Well, I do hope that you enjoyed the show this evening. As I said, if you enjoyed the extended interview format, well, I'll give you some more. We'll bring some more people on air. And we'll go all around the world. We'll find people from South Africa and we'll find people from all over this planet. Put them on and have a good chat. So, tomorrow night, we will go back to chatting and having a bit of fun. And I will meet you at 9 p.m. Same place, same time, on the couch. and we will talk, and we will communicate, and we will form a bond, we'll form a connection, because that's what we're doing here, one person at a time, fishing, baiting the hook. Do you like the sound effects? And one by one, we're going to load that comment section. One by one, we're going to load the viewer figures. One by one, we're going to add people to the club. And one by one, we're going to form the biggest friendship circle in the world on the Tom London Show. So, if this was your first time watching, welcome to the show. We're on every night, 9 p.m. on Facebook Live, on the Tom London Show channel, on my personal channel, on the Kyle Army Racetrack Fans channel, and we're also on YouTube. You can look for me on YouTube by typing in at the Tom London Show. That's where you'll find me on YouTube. Facebook, the official page, is at the Tom London Show. I'm also streaming on Twitch. You will find more platforms to stream on in the future. But let me say to you, go sleep now. Well, if you want to, but at some point you have to. And when you do, I hope you have a peaceful rest. I hope you've been kind to people around you. I hope the people around you are being kind to you. I hope you've got a bit of money in your pocket. I hope your health is good. And if you've got a few problems in your life, well, thank God that they're just a few problems in your life. I'll be back with you again tomorrow night. We'll be talking to each other and raising the roof, raising some hell on the show. Special guest tonight, Stan Katz. Thank you, Stan. And I miss you all. Ready?